Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church of Arlington Heights, where we love boldly because a better world is possible. I'm Melissa Early, the lead pastor, and I use the pronouns she, her, and hers. We'd appreciate it if you'd let us know that you're worshiping with us by going to fumcah.com/live, and there you'll find a place to register your presence as well as the order of service. Today is Palm Sunday. It's the day we remember Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem just days before he was killed. We continue with our Lenten sermon series, Breaking Chains, Finding Freedom in Christ. Christ promises us freedom from those things that get in the way of a full and meaningful life. If you have a Lenten paper chain, then I invite you to take hold of it now. Each link is something that you seek freedom from. Each link could be the same thing, it could be different things. And if you have not yet made one, you might consider making one for just each Sunday of Holy Week, and then each day of Holy Week, and then each day between today and Easter, you might say this prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, grant us freedom from those things that bind us. Grant us freedom from those things that separate us from you and that separate us from our neighbor. God, set us free for full life in you. Amen.
Please join me in this morning's invocation. From Bethlehem to Nazareth, from Jordan to Jericho, from Bethany to Jerusalem, from then to now, come, Lord Jesus, to heal the sick, to mend the brokenhearted, to comfort the disturbed and disturb the comfortable, to cleanse the temple, to liberate faith from convention. Come, Lord Jesus, to carry the cross, to lead the way, to shoulder the sin of the world and take it away. Come, Lord Jesus, today, to this place, to us. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
The Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 12 through 19. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him. They shouted, "Hosanna! Blessings on to the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessings on the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it was written. "Don't be afraid, daughter Zion. Look, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples didn't understand these things at first. After he was glorified, they remembered that these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. The crowd who had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead were testifying about him. That's what the crowd came to meet him, because they had heard about the miraculous sign that he had done. Therefore, the Pharisees said to each other, "See, you've accomplished nothing. Look, the whole world is following him."
There's a lot happening in the life of our church. Today's Kaleidoscope, which is a faith formation activity right after church on Zoom, welcomes two candidates for Village Trustee, Wendy Dunnington and Rich Baldino. They're members of our church. Rich is incumbent and running again, and Wendy is a candidate for one of the positions. They will share with us their insights on what Arlington Heights, what are some unique needs facing Arlington Heights and the Northwest suburbs. So tune in after worship. The Zoom info will be on the screen. Our March mission is Just of DuPage, which is a ministry of one-on-one listening, prayer, and caregiving for inmates of the DuPage County Jail. It helps meet their spiritual needs and empowers them to make positive changes in their lives. Provides help with addiction recovery, education, life skills, social services. Financial donations enable life changes for inmates and their families. You can support this ministry by going to fumcah.com/give or by sending a check to FUMCAH. Mark your donation missions. Since today is Palm Sunday, we are entering Holy Week, a sacred time in the life of the church. So this afternoon at 4 p.m., you can meet here at the church out in the Western parking lot, and we will have a Palm Sunday parade and witness. I really kind of think that that first parade into Jerusalem was the first march by Jesus' followers, a march for justice and advocacy. So we'll be following suit. Meet at 4, you'll get a palm branch to wave. And we'll also have signs that will say freedom from on one side and freedom for on the other. And that's where you can make your witness to what Jesus frees us from, might say greed or racism, and what does Jesus free us for peace, for service, for love. Our Holy Week services this week are, we have Maundy Thursday, or Holy Thursday is this Thursday. We'll have two options for you. Both will have communion. One is at 6 p.m. outdoors in person, about a half hour informal service for prayer and communion. And then a service on Zoom at 7:30. The Zoom link is in the e-news and will be sent out again this week. On Good Friday, we will have a hybrid service. So what this means is that it is a live service in which you can participate either here in the sanctuary or at home on Zoom. The Zoom info, again, will be in the e-news this coming week, and as well as the link to sign up will be in the e-news, or you can go to our website, FUMCAH.com/Easter, where you'll also find our information about our Easter services next Sunday. We'll have our online service at the same time and place, and a drive-in service in our south parking lot at 11 a.m. I know I just threw a lot of information at you. If you didn't quickly scramble and write it all down, that's okay. Just remember this, FUMCAH.com/Easter. It's all right there on the website. I look forward to seeing you live and in person or on Zoom. And now I'm excited to announce our hidden boulders for today. We each Sunday, we've been recognizing people who we want to thank for being hidden boulders, meaning hidden rocks of faith, as well as living, loving boldly, living their love boldly. This week, we want to thank and acknowledge Jonathan Nee and Patrick Nudo. When our former PADS director decided that she needed to step out of leadership of our ministry to homeless people in the Northwest suburbs, Pat stepped in. He didn't miss a beat. And Jonathan Nee stepped in right beside him. We are so grateful to these two men for helping with the PADS meal ministry, leading that ministry during this time of pandemic, and look forward to their leadership when guests return to our church building. Patrick and Jonathan, thank you for being hidden boulders. And now I invite you to take a minute to pass the peace of Christ. You can make a quick phone call, send a quick text message, write on social media, wishing those right around you and those far away the peace of Christ. Peace be with you.
Hello, friends. You may remember my extremely shy puppet friend, Sam. Sam is so shy that isolating in my office for a few months was no big deal for him. But Sam is excited to be in worship today because he heard we were talking about something Sam loves, a parade. That's right. Today is Palm Sunday and we're celebrating a special parade. On Palm Sunday, we remember that Jesus rode into Jerusalem while people cheered and waved palm branches. They said, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." The people knew that something special was happening. In addition to the parade, which Sam loves hearing about, there's also an animal in this story. A donkey carried Jesus on the donkey's back all through the parade. My shy friend wishes that he could have carried Jesus on his back. Sam, I don't think that would ever have worked. But friends, we can all carry Jesus in our hearts. Jesus's love and strength and care for us are always just as close as our hearts. That's something to cheer about. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for this holy week when we remember all that Jesus did on earth. Through him, we can truly know your forgiveness and love for us all. Amen.
Please join me in a prayer in the aftermath of two mass shootings. Let us pray. We stand at the threshold of another holy week, O God, when we will hear again the story of how the disciples failed their teacher and their friend. We will hear again of how they fell asleep when he asked them to stay awake, how they ran when he needed them nearby, how they pretended not to know him, how they looked away when he died. God, we confess that we are too ready to look away from suffering, to turn away from need. For we find ourselves doing it again and again. Even now, in the face of two more mass shootings, one in Atlanta, the other in Boulder, though they could have been anywhere, in Detroit, in Chicago, in San Francisco. Give us courage to turn our faces toward suffering, not as voyeurs who gape and gasp, but as compassionate and courageous followers of Jesus who will take heed and take action. Make us tireless in our work against evil, persistent in our pursuit of peace, and enduring as we love our neighbor. Move us from prayers for peace to actions for it. Move us from praying for comfort for the bereaved to offering it. Move us from praying for healing for broken communities to being those who repair the broken places. God, maybe the disciples ran away because they were afraid and felt powerless. We are afraid and feel powerless. Fill us with your Spirit that we might know where and how to love boldly, to love gently, to love constantly, so that a better world is possible. Amen.
The second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 20 through 26. Some Greeks were among those who had come to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and they made a request. "Sir, we want to see Jesus." Philip told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The time has come for the human one to be glorified. I assure you that unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it can only be a single seed. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their lives will lose them. Those who hate their lives in this world will keep them forever. Whoever serves me must follow me. Wherever I am, there my servants will also be. My Father will honor whoever serves me." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Jesus talked about death a lot. He talked about his own death. He talked about other people's deaths. He talked about how following him meant being willing to die. Even here at this triumphal entry into Jerusalem, he turned it into a conversation about his death. A huge crowd had gathered at the streets to welcome him into Jerusalem. They were there for the Passover festival and they heard he was coming to town. And they grabbed palm branches, which were symbols of national triumph. So they greet Jesus as a national hero. Think ticker tape parade for returning soldiers. The crowd shouts Hosanna and blessed be the one who comes in the name of the Lord, which actually come from a psalm that gives thanks for victory in battle. And Jesus goes right from this amazing moment of triumph to talking about his death. He talks about how a seed must die in order to bear fruit. And then he talks more blatantly about death, that those who love their lives will lose them, and those who hate their lives in this world will keep them forever. What a wet blanket. What a party pooper. He's the guy in the middle of the celebration for the big win that says, yeah, but we're going to lose the next one. He doesn't just talk about his own death, but he says that all those who follow him must die too. Not great news. Who thought he was their hero? He basically says, following me isn't about being on the winning team. The purpose of life isn't to live forever. Well, don't tell that to Peter Thiel, PayPal co-founder, or Larry Ellison, executive chairman and chief technology officer of Oracle Corporation, or Sergey Brin, co-founder of Google, or Dmitry Iskov, a Russian millionaire. These guys are all investing millions of dollars in trying to unlock the secret to immortality. Market research firm Global Industry Analysts says that the anti-aging industry generates more than $80 billion per year. And some of the biggest proponents of radical life extension happen to be billionaires. There's something about amassing more money than you could ever possibly use that naturally makes you hunger for ways to stay alive forever. 32-year-old Dmitry Iskov started 2045 Initiative with the goal of helping humans achieve physical immortality within the next 3 decades. According to his manifesto, which you can look up at www.2045.com, Iskov's main aims are to create technologies enabling the transfer of an individual's personality to a more advanced non-biological carrier and extending life, including to the point of immortality. He says that for us to evolve to neo-humans, that we'll need to give up biological bodies and make a leap into artificial machine bodies as soon as possible. And then our minds can be backed up to cyberspace and we'll just download ourselves into bionic avatars whenever we get a hankering for the thrills of materiality. He says he is 100% certain that humans will achieve immortality by the year 2045. Now, this quest isn't new. Pope Innocent VIII lay on his deathbed in 1492, and 3 10-year-old boys were paid to give their blood to the pontiff. They all died. Boys, pontiff. And after World War I, thousands of rich old men opted for that era's fountain of youth. They had parts of chimpanzees grafted onto parts of themselves in an exclusive medical clinic on the Riviera. Jesus said, those who love their lives will lose them, and those who hate their lives in this world will keep them forever. Jesus' message is totally different from what these guys are looking for. When the Apostle Peter preached in the early church about Jesus being free, that Jesus freeing us from the power of death, I don't think bionic avatars were on his mind. And when we proclaim that Jesus frees us from death, it's not a proclamation that we won't ever die. Jesus doesn't tell us how to avoid death. Rather, he shows us how to embrace it. In his book, Being Mortal, Atul Gawande tells the story of Laura Carstensen, who was 21 with an infant home and a marriage already in divorce proceedings when she got into a terrible car accident. She had a head injury, internal bleeding, and shattered bones. She almost died. As she got better, she realized how close she came to death, and what mattered to her changed. She said, what mattered were other people in my life. I was 21. Every thought I'd had before the accident, was what was I going to do next in life? And how would I become successful or not successful? Would I find the perfect soulmate? Lots of questions like that, which I think are typical of 21-year-olds. All of a sudden, it was like I was stopped in the tracks. When I looked at what seemed important to me, very different things mattered. While she was recovering from her accident, her father enrolled her in a psychology course at college. He actually went to the classroom and recorded the lectures for her. Well, that started her down this field of psychology, where she looked at this experience she had had as she, that it, facing death, different things mattered. And so she developed a hypothesis that how we seek to spend our time may depend on how much time we perceive ourselves to have. When you are young and healthy, you believe you will live forever. You do not worry about losing any of your capabilities, and you are willing to delay gratification, to invest years, for example, in gaining skills and resources for a brighter future. You seek to plug into bigger streams of knowledge and information. You widen your networks of friends and connections instead of hanging out with your mother. When horizons are measured in decades, which might as well be infinity to human beings, you most desire all that stuff at the top of Maslow's pyramid: achievement, creativity, and other attributes of self-actualization. But as your horizon contracts, when you see the future ahead of you as finite and uncertain, your focus shifts to the here and now, to everyday pleasures and the people closest to you. Laura did an experiment with adult men, ages 23 to 66 years old. Some were healthy and some had HIV/AIDS. They were asked to group cards with descriptions of people ranging in how close they were to them, from family members to the author of a book they'd read. And they had to group these descriptions in, group these people into how much they would want to spend half an hour with them. In general, among those who were healthy, the younger the subjects were, the more they prioritized time with people who were potential sources of information or new friendship. However, among the ill, the age differences disappeared. They wanted to spend time with those closest to them. When, as the researchers put it, life's fragility is primed, people's goals and motives in their everyday lives shift completely. It's perspective, not age, that matters most. Jesus said, "Those who love their lives will lose them, and those who hate their lives in this world will keep them forever." Jesus didn't live like someone who hated his life. He had good friends. He paid attention to nature. He loved children. He liked a good party. But he knew that the point of life isn't to hold on to it with a tight grasp, as if you could keep it forever, but rather to live life as a precious gift and spend it on what is most important. I don't think that means necessarily ignoring the life stage you're in. If you're getting your education or building your career, that matters. You still invest in those things for the long term. But Jesus reminds us that it's not all that matters. We are, every one of us, mortal. Of course, we know how Jesus' story ends. He'll be executed by the state, buried in a tomb, and 3 days later, his followers will have the most amazing story of him being raised from the dead. And that story means we don't have to be afraid of death. Death did not end him, and it won't end us. We don't have to live forever in order to have lives of eternal worth. That's the gift of following Jesus in his way of love.
Let us pray. Almighty God, on this day long ago, your son Jesus was celebrated with palms and rejoicing. May we today embrace Jesus' message and echo his ministry. In a world of violence, may we work for justice and peace. Where there is physical lack, may we help provide sustenance. In this holy week, may we remember the ministry and suffering of Jesus. May we both receive and reflect his compassion. Free us from violence and help us to speak words of justice and peace. Comfort us in our grief and guide us in offering comfort to others. Heal our bodies and our spirits. In this global pandemic, may we find ways to equitably provide health care to others. And while we pray that your kingdom will one day fully arrive on earth, grant us energy and wisdom to also work for glimpses of that world, a world free of racism in all its forms, free of homophobia, where people are free from greed and blessed with generosity, free from hatred and fear, and blessed with your kindness and compassion. And so, as we enter Holy Week, may we remember Jesus and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, praying as he taught, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you so much for your ongoing financial support of our church, which helps us continue being the church, even when we can't go to church. You may make a one-time donation or commit to a weekly or monthly gift by going to fumcah.com/give. You, of course, can mail your check to First UMC of Arlington Heights, 1903 East Euclid Avenue, Arlington Heights, Illinois, 60004.
Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, as we bring our gifts today, we recall the crowds in Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday long ago. May we honor and serve Jesus, not for who we might want him to be, but for who he is, the one who brings compassion, healing, justice, and love. O God, you know and offer the gifts we truly need. In thanksgiving, we dedicate our gifts to you. Amen.
Go in peace, knowing that Jesus frees us from the tyranny of death so that we might live and love boldly now. Amen.